Welcome to the first in the Faith Matters lecture series, sponsored by the School of Theology. I'm Don Thorson. I'm the chair of the Faith Matters Committee. And every year we have 2 to 4 lectures where we talk about relevant theological and social issues. And so this year I'd like to introduce the moderator for the evening, Dr. Rob Mathia.
Thanks for coming out tonight. Just to add to what Dr. Thorson said, in our Faith Matters series, all the speakers are from our own School of Theology, and so it's a way of using the resources of this school to serve the greater university. As Dr. Thorson said, I'm Rob Mathia. I teach in the seminary in the ministry department, and I do not know what it is like to live in a black man in 2016. I myself am the product of an interracial marriage. My father's from Malaysia. Ethnically, he is Sri Lankan Tamil. My mother is from North Dakota, of German and Scottish background, as well as some other things mixed in. So I have a personal interest in issues of race, but the history of African Americans in our country is unique. It contains some different aspects than the histories of other minorities. So I'm here not because I have lived that experience, because I choose to be an ally, and I am called to join in God's work of pursuing justice where there is oppression, so that all men and women are treated with dignity and equality. That's a complex task. It's a complex conversation. Tonight is one little piece in a big and ongoing conversation. We're glad you're here to be a part of it. The format this night will go like this. I'll introduce a speaker. That panelist will come and share. I've given each panelist up to 12 minutes. And then we'll hear from the next one. After we've heard from each panelist, there's going to be a time for questions and comments from you. So we'll have 2 cordless mics, 2 people holding those mics. I invite you, if you want to say something, to form a line leading up to that mic. You'll be able to ask your question or make your comment, and our panelists will then have some time to respond. Well, let's get to it then. Our first panelist for this evening is Dr. Jacqueline Winston, professor of church history and chair of the undergraduate department of theology. She's also an ordained minister in the Foursquare denomination, and a daughter of a civil rights activist. Her family was the first African-American family in Sherman Oaks, California in 1970, having moved from South Bend, Indiana after the national unrest in the late 1960s in the Chicago area. As a historian and as our first speaker, Dr. Winston will provide some historical context for the Black Lives Matter movement. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Winston.
Thank you. I want to talk to you a little bit. If we're going to have this kind of a discussion, it's helpful to understand people's social location. Your worldview is shaped by a number of different factors, and that's the same with mine. What I wanted to do before I got into specifically the Black Lives Matter movement, because I have some basic things I'm hoping to do in my short time with you. Those things include kind of telling you my perspective, especially as the daughter of someone who grew up during the Civil Rights Movement, to talk about then basically to define some historical things like what is racism. To explain some misunderstandings about the nature of the African-American experience, and also then to connect us to what's happening in the Black Lives Matter movement, how it came about, how it arose, and then to do a very small and short contrast of it with the Civil Rights Movement. So, let me just start with me. Now, originally I was going to do some slides and ran out of time, but the slides were really of my family, because telling you a little bit about my family makeup would help you to understand something about the nature of my experience. For one thing, I was born in 1955. Yes, I don't mind telling my age. And that meant that I was born right after the death of Emmett Till. And so for those of you who don't know who Emmett Till was, he was a young black boy from Chicago, and he had gone to Money, Mississippi to stay with relatives and visit them. And he was in a store around the area of that was owned by whites, and he whistled. Now, sometimes what they'll say is he whistled at a white woman, but the truth is we don't really know that he necessarily whistled at her, but he whistled. And because he whistled, he was taken that night, and he was horribly mutilated, killed, and strung up and killed. And you have a whole series of just horrendous things that happened to blacks in this country from the 50s up and through the civil rights movement. When I grew up in South Bend, Indiana, and many people know South Bend, Indiana as the home of Notre Dame, and it is, and it's a wonderful place. But what a lot of people don't know is that South Bend actually then and now was two worlds. You had the people who were on the side where Notre Dame was, and then you had people like myself who lived on the west side, and that's where the blacks were. And I particularly grew up not just on the west side, but where I grew up doesn't actually even exist anymore. It was just known as the block. And we lived above a store, and that was the corner where all the pimps and the prostitutes and drug dealers and everybody was. And that was my upbringing. What was different was that my father was educated. He had done very well, and he refused to accept the standard rule, which the standard rule was is if you were a black man, you were expected to work at a company called Bendix. That's what was expected of you. It didn't matter that you had a degree. And my mother, one of the reasons I was going to show you the pictures was my family had not only external dynamics, but internal dynamics in that my mother, though she was an African American, looked white, and both my brother and sister looked white. They were both blonde. And so some of you may know about certain things of racism, but some of you may not know about something that's called a paper bag test. A paper bag test in this country meant if you were lighter than a paper bag, you were acceptable. But if you were darker than a paper bag, you were not acceptable. And so we had a number of dynamics. So to shorten that and to make that go faster is my father was influential in stopping, because the riots, we always talk about the riots, we think of them out here, we think of them in Chicago, but the riots that happened in the 60s were all over the U.S., including in my own city, and even though it was a small one. And it was my father who was, to be honest, influential in stopping the riots there. I remember very clearly them saying, they're going to kill your dad, which they didn't. And from the work that my father ended up doing with United Way in that place, we were asked to move. My father was asked to come to Los Angeles and work with United Way here. And as was said, we were the first black family there. Now, in combination with that, we had a number of interesting little issues. Because we lived in Sherman Oaks, there's a certain unspoken rule. And that is, in certain communities, people of color can go in the morning because they're expected that they're domestics, but you better be driving the opposite direction at night. That's assumed. And so my father would tend to be, it looks like we're getting ready to get a little rain. My father would tend to be stopped by the police almost every night. And in fact, sometimes it was the same policeman who would stop him every night wanting to know where he was going and why he was going the wrong direction. So that's just a little bit of my background. Now, I wanted to then talk about racism. And I want to just say something really important about racism. There's a divide in the country. And the divide in the country is, why do we have to talk about this again? We always talk about it. It's always brought up. Why can't Why can't you people just get over it? Well, I just want to say something to you from a Christian point of view. The reason we can't get over it is because racism is the unrepentant sin of our nation. And there's a difference between saying you're sorry something happened and repenting of it. And to repent of it is to change those things. To repent means to turn and go the opposite direction. And so I believe the reason we can't get over it is because we really haven't repented of it. Now, I wanted to just tell you then another thing, just a few things that sometimes is a historical issue. You will find later on they're going to give you, if you want it, a bibliography that I've put together of different writings. Some of them are websites simply because the Black Lives Matter issue it's so new that there isn't a lot, but there's some stuff on it. But also on there is a book by a scholar named Lerone Bennett, and it's called Before the Mayflower. One of the mistaken misunderstandings about the history of slavery in this nation is that the first blacks in this nation were slaves. They were not. The first blacks in this nation were actually indentured servants. And the reason that's important is they came just like everybody else did. You couldn't afford passage. You wanted to go to a new place and have a new life. So what did you do? You agreed to work for usually like 7 years, and they would pay for your passage. So the first blacks came here in 1619, even before the Pilgrims, and they came here as indentured servants. They lived, they intermarried with whites, and they held office. But what happens is, sometime later, probably sometime around the 30s or so, towards the 40s, there are two major things that happen. One, the creation of the cotton gin, and two, a recognition that, hey, sugar not only is great in tea, but it makes the best rum in the world. And therefore, it causes this big push and increase in industry. And they need a cheap and a quick labor force, and they decide that the labor force that will work are black Africans. Because guess what? If they run away, you can catch them and identify them. So a series of laws will be passed in the 30s, 40s, up through the 60s that are intended, they were intended to break the connection between blacks of a class and whites of the same class. And included in those were, for example, miscegenation laws. And miscegenation, for those of you that don't know what that means, it means that people of an opposite race supposedly can't marry. And so by the time you get to the 1660s, the laws having to do with slavery have been institutionalized and made a part of our national identity. Okay, thank you. That fast. Okay, so where does this take us to? That came faster than, oh yeah, okay. Okay, so what I want to say then with regard to the Black Lives Matter movement. Three women, Alicia Garza, Patrice Cullors, and Opal Tometi, were responding to the problem of what had happened was Trayvon Martin, this was in 2013, he's the young man who was killed by a neighborhood watch person, and for being in the wrong place at the wrong time, and he's the one who had a bag of Skittles and an iced tea, and he was shot and killed. And when the verdict came back that completely exonerated him, one of the young women writes a Facebook passage and talks about the importance of black lives. And her friend tweets back and creates the hashtag Black Lives Matter. The movement takes a big kick, and when it takes a big kick is the following year when in Ferguson, Michael Brown is killed by police, and there's a great unrest. Now, because I have a short amount of time, I just want to say a couple things real quickly. The Black Lives Matter movement, a lot of people are questioning whether, one, it has validity. But I want to say a couple things that's really important. When the civil rights movement happened, the evangelical church was on the opposite side. And I challenge us not to make the same mistake. A lot of people are not aware of how positively we speak about Martin Luther King now, but how badly he was spoken about during the time that he was doing his ministry, including that they would say he wasn't really Christian and all he was a communist. Now, I don't carry all of the same strategies that Black Lives Matter might. I think that the Black Lives Matter movement is much more of a millennial movement. And therefore, some of the edginess that is more characteristic of your generation is part of what it is. But here's one of the interesting things. If you pay very careful, close attention to the Black Lives Matter movement, how am I doing? I've got about one more? Okay. Okay. And what you will notice is that though it's called Black Lives Matter, it is multicultural. You watch the protests and you will see it has people of all colors. In fact, one of the things that they just did just recently is a group of Black Lives Matter people are standing with the people with the indigenous people at Standing Rock right now against the ruination of the water and of their sacred land. So I just want to bring that up. I'm going to stop, and maybe, depending on how our time goes, later on I can answer some more questions. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Winston. We look forward to, we'll get to hear more of her comments as we go. Our next panelist is Dr. Jessica Wong, assistant professor in the Department of Theology. Dr. Wong did her PhD at Duke University under two of the most influential African-American theologians today, Willie Jennings and J. Cameron Carter. And she wrote a PhD dissertation with this title. I'll read it and then I'll translate it for you. The Anti-Iconicity of Blackness, a theological reading of the modern racial optic, which in really highly oversimplified terms means she looked at how blackness is viewed and analyzed it theologically. She has written and presented on race in a number of venues. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Jessica Wong.
Well, thank you for being here, and thank you for inviting me. So we are here because we know that something is wrong with how our society is functioning. We recognize the inequality and the violence. We know the sad statistics and the studies. We're here as people who recognize these injustices in our society, and we know that our social body is sick. It is a deep-rooted illness. We are here as people who care about this illness and are demanding steps towards healing. But we are also here as Christians. And as Christians, we are called to seek truth. We must ask the hard questions about how We must ask the hard questions and be honest about the answers. How do we as Christians understand and engage the concerns of the Black Lives Matter movement? How do we make sense of and confront the problem of police-involved shootings, of an unarmed black man, of mass incarceration, of structurally established inequality? To begin, we must understand the epidemic of blue-on-black violence not as a problem of a handful of racist police officers, because the problem is so much bigger than that. Instead, the issue is that we live in a society corrupted by a racialized way of seeing the world. Our sight has been perverted. Instead of seeing the person standing in front of me as he or she is, my sight is clouded by a robust narrative attached to particular bodies. These are dark stories attached to dark bodies, shaped over time through the consumption of news, casual jokes, TV shows, film. This formation of our shared social imagination impacts how we visually read and categorize others. According to a study by the American Psychological Association, when white and black boys of the same age and the same build are viewed side by side, the black boy is typically perceived to be bigger, older, and more violent than his white counterpart. Frantz Fanon, a black theorist writing during the 1950s, described his own experience of being visually identified through the lens of race. He describes a scene in which he's riding a train to Paris and encounters a young white boy and his mother. As soon as the white boy sees Fanon, he clings to his mother's skirts and exclaims, "Mama, see the Negro, I'm frightened." As soon as Fanon is identified in this way, he feels himself fixed by this image of blackness. He talks about feeling weighed down by this image, deafened by the tom-toms and cannibalism. He feels trapped by the image that has been projected upon his body. "The Negro is an animal, the Negro is bad, the Negro is mean, the Negro is ugly," Fanon says, articulating the way in which the white boy saw him, articulating the way in which the white world saw him. The appraisal of dark bodies as criminal, as unnaturally strong, as demonic, these are the characteristics that constitute the image of blackness that is projected upon dark bodies. This visual assessment happens in an instant, in the time it takes to determine whether this person is a threat or not, in the time it takes to decide whether or not to pull the trigger. The blood of Michael Brown, of Alton Sterling, of Philando Castile is not only on the hands of law enforcement. These shootings are a product of the perverted racialized sight that infects our whole society. We as members of the society, all of us, have been habituated into a problematic way of seeing one another. After all, it's not only white police officers who are statistically more likely to shoot black men. We have all been habituated into this problematic way of seeing. Racism is deep-seated in the modern Western social imagination. And this part is hard for us to hear, especially as Christians. But racism has been intertwined with many instantiations of Western Christianity. And at this point, I'm going to be talking primarily to my white brothers and sisters. There is a long-standing link between whiteness and Christianity. Ever since the Age of Expansion, a conceptual bond has been created between being a Christian, being civilized, and being a white European. In fact, this link became so strong that conversion was expected to be accompanied by the approximation of European culture, that is, of taking on European housing, European dress, European food. Failure to do so was seen as a sign of one's persistent paganism and incivility. This connection between whiteness and Christianity also produced the light-skinned, blue-eyed, long-flowing brown-haired Jesus. You all know the image. It is this Jesus that many of us grew up with. It is this Jesus that shaped our imaginations as children. Without even thinking about it, we made a conceptual link between Jesus and whiteness. And if Jesus becomes white, what other attributes are we implicitly connecting with whiteness? Perhaps goodness, orderliness, true humanity? It has been easy to make Jesus look like me. We've been doing it for years. Jesus made comfortable, Jesus made congruent with my way of living. Jesus made easily consumable, Jesus made white. However, I would like to challenge us tonight. If Jesus is easy for us to live with, if he doesn't feel foreign to us in any way, then perhaps we have forgotten who he is and who we are. Jesus is not like us. He is not a white man or a generic human being. He is a Palestinian Jewish man, likely with swarthy skin, brown eyes, curly hair. He is the dark-bodied Jewish man. And we are not Jewish Christians. At least, probably most of us aren't. We're not naturally part of the chosen people, though we have often positioned ourselves in this way. Most of us are Gentiles. We are the outsiders who have been grafted in by grace, Paul tells us in Romans 11. But despite our humble position, we have skipped over this part of the story. Instead, we jump to the end, the part where we are wholly incorporated into the body of Christ. And we've gone one step further. We've not only overlooked the unstable position that attends our Gentile existence, Historically speaking, Christians have made an exclusive claim on Jesus by superseding the Jewish people, conceptually situating ourselves as Israel, and making Jesus a white European. There is a gap that exists between Israel's chosenness and our Gentile existence. It is a gap that is certainly overcome, but it is overcome by Jesus, not by us. It is a gap overcome despite us, not because of us. By whitewashing Jesus' Jewishness and forgetting our Gentile identities, we have covered over our foreignness through our own power. We have skipped over our otherness. We have imagined away our need for humility and replaced it with pride. It is this poor theology that contributes to the problem of the modern racial optic, that is, the way in which we see each other through the lens of race. Our poor theology has distorted the call of Christianity into something all too compatible with white, upper middle class American ways of life. We have domesticated Jesus. We have made him into our image and in turn made ourselves like God. And as a result, we have marginalized non-white bodies. The implicit concern that has been made between whiteness and Jesus has produced a very different reading of the black body. The connection between whiteness and Jesus has shaped our social imagination and, in turn, the modern racial optic. It has established this perverted way of seeing. Again, I'm reminded of Fanon, the Negro is the animal, the Negro is bad, the Negro is mean, the Negro is ugly. This is a byproduct of the white Jesus. So what do we do? How are we as Christians to move forward from here? I think that one starting point is recognizing that we've been habituated into a perverted way of seeing the world, ourselves, and others. We are in need of a redeemed visual logic. Part of seeking this healing is recognizing the ways in which our white idea of Jesus has perpetuated a hierarchy of race in which whiteness reigns supreme. It's time for us to understand that Jesus is not a comfortable affirmation of my way of life. Jesus is not an upper-class white man. He is a dark-bodied Jewish man. And I, on the other hand, am a Gentile who's grafted into God's chosen people by grace. Seeing in myself in this way means that I do not approach Jesus with pride and ownership, but with humility, the humility of the Syrophoenician woman, as one who comes on her knees. I approach Jesus as a Gentile woman who is reminded of her non-chosen status by Jesus himself, who tells her that he is sent only to the lost house of Israel. And only after her demonstration of humility is she welcomed in. What might this recasting of our vision of ourselves and of Jesus accomplish? What might this humility enable? I'd like to suggest that humility is the first step in decoupling the connection that has been established between whiteness and Jesus. It is the first step in creating space for a new visual logic, one that resists established images of blackness and whiteness that are housed within our social imagination. By recognizing that I have not seen things rightly, I open myself up to encountering the world in a new way. I open myself to creating new narratives about myself and those around me. The formation of these new narratives and images doesn't have to take place in a radical way. It can occur through seemingly small acts, through the act of sharing a meal with someone who doesn't look like me, through the act of listening, through the act of making a new friend, and perhaps most profoundly, through the act of falling in love. In these ways, we begin to construct a new visual logic, one based upon joining instead of division. This is the alternative relationality of the kingdom of God. This is the alternative relationality enacted in and offered by Jesus, for it is in his body that the Jew and the Gentile are made one.
Thank you, Dr. Wong. Our third speaker is Dr. Greg Motor, Associate Professor of Practical Theology in the Department of Practical Theology. Much of his life has revolved around urban and inner city settings. He is a recurrent urban dweller, having lived in inner city Tacoma, inner city Oakland, and for a number of years lived directly adjacent to the Bio Vista Housing Project, the largest Section 8 housing complex in the Bay Area. In addition to his extensive experience as a pastor in inner city contexts, He has been an Urban Ministries educator for over 20 years. Please welcome Dr. Greg Motor.
Thank you. It's a distinct honor for me to be included on this panel and to speak on this timely and important topic with good colleagues, whom I also consider to be good friends, and I sincerely hope the feeling is mutual. So if not, let me down easy. Yeah. When thinking through the importance and the implications of Black Lives Matter, I think the observation can be made that it is at once a concept, or more accurately, an outcry, a movement, and an organization. Its significance is not just tied to one thing, but rather these multiple things simultaneously. And perhaps like concentric circles, they exist separately but overlap as well. In this short period of time, I have many things to say, but probably what I will address will be in more of the conceptual category, Black Lives Matter as a public outcry. And if time permits, perhaps I'll get into the other two. First, let me say something about where I'm coming from that informs my perspective as I engage this subject matter. I find myself today as a Gentile. Thank you, Dr. Wong, and also a Caucasian, the Heinz 57 mutt style, Irish, English, Dutch, French, and German. And I'm not mad about it. I've come to grips with it, I guess. I struggled for many years to get to this place, and I've learned to accept my whiteness. It's good, and it's not so good, stuff that's connected to it. We have a lot of work to do. Yeah. But I would also like to add, I consider myself to be bicultural. As one who's been deeply impacted and warmly embraced by the African American community in Oakland and Richmond, California, my life has been changed and transformed by the lifelong relationships I've gained from that part of my journey. I want to recognize at the onset that the phrase Black Lives Matter is a passionate cry. It's the type of cry that comes in the wake of ongoing violence and systemic neglect. And as both a Christian and a minister, I want to stress the importance that we, again, that we've already heard, that we as Christ followers need to listen to this cry, this pain-filled declaration. We need to make room for it and for the grief that is connected to it, not to dismiss it, not to ignore it, not to try to debunk it, but to start with just listen.
Yes.
Black lives matter. This is the sort of cry that's reminiscent of the cry of the people in the Old Testament. Talking with my colleague, Dr. Bill Yarkin, who's one of our resident Old Testament Hebrew profs, he affirms this people's cry is well established in the Old Testament. In the Hebrew, the term za'ak, and its correlate, sa'ak. Za'ak is the people's cry that God hears, and it's always a cry in response to violence, as it's broadly understood. This is Exodus 2. This is the cry of God's people that comes up to his ears. This is Isaiah 5. This is Genesis and Cain and Abel, where the blood of Abel is crying out. And it goes up to God's ears, and God responds to this cry by initiating his words, his movements, in conjunction with the prophetic tradition towards deliverance and judgment. Deliverance and justice. I first heard this cry, really felt it, when my wife and I relocated after seminary to live and work in Patton University community in East Oakland. And in Oakland at that time, and it's still the same way, the death toll, the homicide rate had been skyrocketing in that community. Just the violent crime, on average, 3 shootings a day, homicide, rape, so many things are among the highest percentages in the country. And it's also the case that there's a significantly understaffed police force there. 18 police persons for every 10,000 individual. The next closest comparable city has 45 for 10,000 people. So we witnessed, we heard, we felt awful things in the Fruitvale district alone, and it was in many respects a war zone. And I saw something beautiful that I saw for the first time in the African American Christian community. Centered in the heart of all this violence and upheaval is a fellowship of pastors, nonprofit leaders, men but also women, and a few folks like me that could have been considered outsiders, but we were received with the hospitality usually reserved for family. And I saw, yes, and became a part of this group who demonstrated for me the unusual capacity to hear, to cry, and to care for the brokenness of their community, while at the same time organizing and speaking a collectively affirmed position to persons of power for the change that we desperately needed to have in order for our families to be well together. Activism can get you noticed, but it's community organizing that I learned from them that gets you heard. What surprises me is that many people have yet to hear that cry, Black Lives Matter, in a way that they enter into the grief of it. And I think we heard from Dr. Wong why this might be the case. And this is such an important question and important insight. As I've reached out, it seems to be a case that a lot of what we do as a group, when we come in contact to another group, just happens as a part of our social conditioning. We've been socialized into certain cultural behaviors and norms in response to a particular group, and we go along with it. We don't analyze or question the behavior, we just go along with the flow, never really stopping to ask the question, or rather to question the notion if this is the right behavior or the right outcome, or what a good outcome might be as opposed to what's not so good. This dynamic has been studied to agree in social psychology and what has become known as intergroup contact theory. And this has been helpful for me as a basic framework to use to assess and to think through, to understand what is happening in this type of group behavior, so I can better understand what's going on with my group, so I can better understand what's going on with me, so I can choose, recognize, and even work on behavior skills that will help me to improve and potentially improve my group towards good outcomes. How much time do I have? Oh my gosh, we're gonna take a plane ride. According to Bachner, a historic overview of the various outcomes of intergroup contact shows that they can be classified into four more or less mutually exclusive categories. These categories are genocide. Two groups come together, and one group removes or kills off the other group. Pretty basic stuff. Secondly, assimilation. Two groups come together, one group forces the other group to adapt their culture. Three, segregation. Two groups come together, and they keep a safe distance from each other and minimize contact. And four, integration. For Bachner, this is defined as an accommodation that comes about when two different groups maintain their respective core cultural identities while at the same time merging into a superordinate group in other equally important respects. For Bachner, integration is the desired outcome of intergroup intercultural contact. This is so because integration addresses the real issue, which is how to equitably improve and restore relations between. And again, let me stress, equitably improve and restore relations between members of different cultures. The other alternatives sidestep the issue through attempting to solve the difficulty of intercultural contact through one form or another of eradication. By eradicating the people who are different, genocide. By eradicating the differences, assimilation, or eradicating the contact, segregation. Bachner also describes the psychological responses of addressing difficulties in intergroup contact at the individual level in four categories: passing, exaggerated chauvinism, marginality, and cultural mediation. And passing is like that old school term, passing, where you come in contact with another culture and you dip. You actually put aside your cultural orientation in order, if you can, in order to fit in to the other culture. Let's see, I've lost my place. Exaggerated chauvinism, you come in contact with the other culture, and instead of moving in towards it, you back into your culture of origin. And in backing into your culture of origin, you become more solidified in ethnocentrism and into chauvinism than you previously were. It's like you stepped out, you tried that, it's not working, and so I'm going to stay here for good. The third is marginalized, and it's kind of like the missionary kid, right? It's where you don't really feel at home in your own culture, and then when you come in contact with the other culture, you don't really feel at home in it as well, so you just kind of shift back and forth between those two cultures without really making any deep cultural commitments in either world. And then finally, it's this idea of being a mediating person. Mediating persons have the capacity to act as links between different cultural systems, bridging cultural gaps by introducing, translating, representing, and reconciling respective groups to each other. The other potentials fall short because they attempt in one form or another to evade the problem by pretending it doesn't exist through passing, rejecting culture of origin, by backing away from it through exaggerated chauvinism, retreating back into the culture of origin, or by evading commitment through marginality, vacillating between two cultures, feeling at home between neither. Only the mediating response addresses the problem head-on by providing a genuine framework for the acquisition of multicultural responses, skills, and self-perceptions. I'm out of time. I want to ask some questions to leave you with. If I can't hear, why? What type of response do I gravitate towards when I come in contact with other groups? Do I evade? Does my world seek to eradicate? Do these influences keep me from hearing the cries of the other? Thank you.
Thank you so much for that piece. And our final speaker for this evening is Michael Mata, who teaches in the seminary and is the director of the Los Angeles track of our Master of Arts in Transformational Urban Leadership. Michael has over 30 years of experience connected to urban ministries, working as a consultant, trainer, and professor. He has led several significant projects related to understanding the role of faith-based organizations in community service and transformation. He was at a meeting of that kind just this morning, he was telling me about. He is a community organizer who was very involved in the rebuilding efforts following the 1992 race riots in LA. And he helped to organize the African American, Latino, and Korean evangelical leadership. Please welcome Michael Mata.
I'm going to give you the punchline. Black lives do matter. But I'm going to share my journey in my life, starting with what happened today and work back to when I was a boy in Texas. This morning, I was part of, as Professor Rob already mentioned, of an event that was bringing together various religious leaders to deal with a pandemic in South LA. There is a breakout of sexually transmitted diseases in South LA, and we are the epicenter, if not in the United States, certainly in California, where females of color, primarily African American females, ages 12 to 24, are being affected and infected by syphilis, gonorrhea, and chlamydia. These are infections that can be prevented and treatable. But it's been going on for over 30 years. Over 30 years. And if it's not dealt with, these females, and it's already happened, can, among other health repercussions, become infertile. Is this an institutionalized genocide of a community? That was the question we were raising, grappling with. There are social determinants that bring these young women and men into this predicament. But the fact is that it's been going on too long. And finally, we're getting the faith community to respond that this is unacceptable to our females of color, and in particular African-American females in South LA. Unacceptable. Well, from there, I went over to another meeting, and I do a lot of helping bridge new groups of people into loving LA, acculturating them, understanding what it means to be part of American society, and enjoying just the cultural diversity of Los Angeles, Southern California. And this person happened to be a female, non-Caucasian, and she was looking at a InStyle magazine, right? What's the latest fashion? Do you want to be, you know, hip? Want to be in, you know, be part of the landscape and have a little bit of beauty and status? So she wanted to go with me and was asking me which of these women are beautiful. And I was like, okay. Yeah, they all look beautiful because they all reflect God's image. I'm not going to deny that. But she kept looking at that, and as I looked with her in that magazine, I noticed that 99.9% of the women in that InStyle magazine were Caucasian, of Eurocentric descent. And those that you can actually maybe discern were people of color, they were very fairly fair-skinned. They really blended in because you're looking at the jewelry and the dress, and you go, wow, this is, what were we promoting here? And this woman came to me, turned around and said, you know, I think I'm going to redo my eyes. And I said, why? And she happened to be of Asian background. Because I want to look like these people in the magazine. I want to be more American. Very troubling discussion we had that ensued after that, you know, interaction. It brought me back to when I went to a Christian college. One of my degrees is in biblical literature, another one's in religion. And in that time of study, all the theologians at that time that I was being introduced to were of European extraction. Hans Kuhn, that's a great one. Pannenberg, great. And then, you know, Bultmann and Paul Tillich and all those Germanic, you know, people. And it seems like the intelligence reside there in Europe. And so when all of a sudden I was given a book because my longtime favorite professor thought I was foreign born, gave me this book by Gustavo Gutierrez, I felt like I was liberated. I actually was reading somebody who reflected my experience of being dehumanized by the dominant culture. But it was not seen as legitimate or acceptable theology. It was kind of like ad hoc and faddish. And so when I went to seminary, I said, I don't want to spend more time understanding the roots of this movement in the majority world, the voices from the margins. And I was shy. I said, well, again, that's the fad. It will pass. What you really need to know and read are these European theologians and a few American-born theologians. Now, I don't know about you, but it continued to underscore what I experienced as a young man. When I would wake up in the morning and look into the mirror, and this dark spirit says, you are deficient. You have a defect. And that defect is that you do not have blonde hair or blue eyes. And then I prayed, why, God, did you make me of Mexican extraction? I don't know if, I hope you never have to experience that when you look into the mirror and the spirit tells you, you are not worthy unless you look like someone else, right? And sure enough, I think right now, cosmetics, you can buy all kind of lightning skin kind of things and tone it down and, you know, do other things to your physical appearance to kind of look like somebody else. Well, I mentioned that because when I was a boy and I grew up in Texas, and in LA they're always asking you, where are you from? And I said, I'm from here. No, what do you mean? You know, they always say, where's your parents from? I go, we're from here. And that's a reminder, hey, you don't remember the Alamo? You know, my ancestors went to bed Mexicanos, and they woke up Tejanos, right? That's the reality. The border crossed my family. We've been here.
Yeah.
You know, when Columbus showed up at the shores, the only thing he discovered was he was lost. India's over there, not here, you know? But I grew up being called a Mexican. And everybody else outside of the African-American community were called Americans. Are you tracking with me on that one? Mm-hmm. Everybody who was not a dark skin was an American, and everybody was different. So I grew up really with this identity of being, I'm a Mexican. But that Mexican-ness brought other issues along the way. So I don't know about your culture, but mine was, you know, there's a sense of shame and embarrassment if something happens to you that maybe brings disparaging perspective on your family. So I was kept after school time and time again because I was getting A's on my tests. And so you're only kept after school if you did something wrong. I didn't know what I was doing wrong. I thought, because my parents and my father said, you will go to school no matter what, unless you have two broken legs and two broken arms, then maybe we might excuse you from going to school. Because education was very important to me. But so I was like, the teachers were gods, and I had to listen to them. And they would tell me what I should know about life and what I should know in terms of knowledge. It would give me value and help me get on with life. But I was being kept after school because I was doing something wrong. Do you know what they were thinking I was doing?
Cheating.
Because I was a Mexican. I didn't know that. I just thought that was me. I was the problem. And so I had to kind of scurry on home and tell my parents that I was kept after school, and they would say, why, what did you do wrong? And I want to say, I don't know. And they would say, yes, you do know. You did something wrong. And that was very, very troubling for me. And I didn't know why. I'm only 6 and 7 year olds. Only later in college did I reflect back, oh, they were telling me I was deficient because of the of my ethnicity. I hope you never have to kind of experience that. Because even though I grew up in a pastor's home and faith was very important to me, I really didn't understand myself to be created in the image of God. Because the standards were the American standards. And that unless I didn't reflect those, then I was less than. Now, there was a time in Texas that definitely we had division, much like in the, you know, further and deeper in the South, that Mexicans were over here and everybody else over here. And of course, the African Americans were just not on the radar at times. So I inherit that experience and knowledge, and it began to really shape who I have become. That understanding is that we are created image of God. Every one of us. We are created. The gender you have, your gender identity, that is God-given. The permanent tan that I have, that's God-given, right? That's precious. Yes. But I wish my church at that time would have told me that. I even wish my theology department in my Christian school would have told me that. I wish I didn't have to spend most of my life at that time to understand that I am precious. That I could say to that spirit, when I looked into the mirror, stand, get thee behind me, Satan. I reject that I'm less than because I have dark hair, I have dark skin, and I'm of a Mexican heritage. I appreciate what the complexity and the beauty that all you represent here. Because if one of you is missing, then I lose out on who God is.
That's right.
You bring a unique experience and understanding that I will never have, but I need you to share that with me, because in that journey together, I have a fuller, deeper, more profound understanding of the love of God and the grace of God and who Jesus Christ is. If you're gone, then I have only a certain unfinished profile of the face of God.
That's right.
So I wanted to tell that young lady, you are precious as an Asian. And to tell the young women in South LA, you are precious because you're in God's image. And we as a people of faith have failed you, because we've allowed that insidious, broken system of the health system not to make you whole. So that's the journey. That's why I believe Black lives matter, do matter, because if they don't matter, then none of us matter. None of us matter. But it is their experience that continue to hold us accountable for the way things are and need to change. Some of us were very good, like, amen. Obama was elected president, and we felt like we've really achieved. And we've noticed in the last few years, we have almost gone back, but it's only been the reality that's always been there. No, I've been a product of it. I've had implicit bias towards women, then thinking they could handle us intellectually. I've even had implicit bias by saying, well, you know, some African Americans, they just don't get it. You know, I've been there because the dominant culture in which I was educated, right? The educational system supports the culture in many ways. So I was taught that. It wasn't just like I knew that. I was taught that. So I, on a daily basis, have to work with and say that all people matter. But my brothers and sisters who are of African descent continue to help me on that journey. Certainly the strategies and approaches may differ from this old guy, but I need them. I need them to remind me that we are all precious in God's sight. God bless you.
Okay, my question is, what shall we do next?
I like the pronoun we, because it isn't just not one of us up here. Any of you could have come up here and shared your story, written something very articulate like my colleagues, and help us further understand that. So I think this is the beginning. If it's not already beginning, it has been going on already, I mean, in very informal ways. But we need to dialogue and hear each other's stories. The understanding of that, because it's out of that engagement, I believe, that then if I listen to you, if I seek to understand, not to just be understood, then I learn something that we can work together. I don't have anything prescribed because I'm not into models, but there are some principles and practices that we can engage, and we look to the scriptures, the sacred texts that helps informs who we are and what we need to do. I mean, this isn't new. You know, there were some people in the Acts that we read that were kind of being marginalized and not taken care of. And it took some wisdom of some leadership to say, hey, we cannot deny that these women need to be taken care of. Just because they're of a different ethnic background doesn't mean that we deny them. So that tension is there, and we're still working on that. So what is a specific next step? Then you and I need to talk about what those will be.
Yeah, and I would just quickly say that I think we need to move from a national discussion and the resonance, allow this resonance from the national discussion and this outcry that we're hearing to really motivate us to roll up our sleeves and do the hard work, the hard regional work of community organizing. Yeah.
I also think another important issue is, I think we have to begin with repentance. Mm-hmm. And I think we have to be willing to listen
And even if we don't agree with the methods, we need to not lose sight of the message. And that message has to be that if we are to be like Christ, then that means that our priorities, and one of the things I think we absolutely have to do is make a distinction between things that we think are godly but are actually American versus that which is what Jesus would have us to be.
No, it's an excellent question. Is it me? So I think part of it is it's a lot harder, because I mean, part of what we're talking about is dialogue and listening, right? And it's a lot harder to listen to people that we don't know and trust. But if we can imagine hearing the pain and the suffering of a friend, how different, how much does that change things for us, right? So what does it look like to enter into friendships and relationships, to learn to really know somebody in a way that you learn to care passionately about what they care about? And I think we also have to remember as Christians, the radical reality of the waters of baptism, mm-hmm. right? What does it mean to actually take that seriously? I think if we aren't scared by the call of baptism, of what that really means, that we are joining our bodies with people that we do not know, that our families might not approve of, that are radically different from us, right? I mean, we are joining together as one body with so many different people. That needs to change how we actually encounter one another.
Thanks, let's go to this side.
Hi, how would you guys address the critics who say by supporting the Black Lives Matter movement, we're therefore saying other lives don't matter?
That's a common question. And I think the problem here is an attitude that assumes to say that if I say you are valuable, then I'm saying this person here is not valuable. And I think that's at the core of that is a fallacy. The fact of the matter is there is a much greater likelihood that if I'm stopped by the police, something negative could happen to me that might not happen to my white counterpart. It's a frightening thing to think. I don't have any children, but it's a frightening thing to think that we are back, and I, having grown up in the civil rights movement, I remember the talk. And now parents have to have the talk again. And what the talk is called, the way it goes is you have to tell especially your sons, you keep your hands at 10 and 2. When you drive, and if you are stopped, you don't accidentally or quickly reach for your license, and you ask each step along the way, and you have to go through a whole process that other people don't have to go through. To say that there is not an absolute difference in the experience is to deny the reality. We're not saying blue lives don't matter. We're not saying Latino lives don't matter. What we're doing is addressing a systemic, consistent problem that our nation needs to admit exists and needs to change.
Anybody else want to respond to that?
I think implicit in Black Lives Matter is this sort of unheard too, Black Lives Matter too also.
Yes. Let's go to the side.
Hi, I really appreciated how you walked through the Backner model and that the ideal is to become mediators between communities. I know there's a lot of opportunities on campus with BSA and APASO and International Chapel, and off campus in service, opportunities to enter into different communities. What are some steps that we can keep in mind so that we can become the mediators and not the other reactions that you talked about?
I think there's probably a lot of people up here that could respond to this perhaps even better than I could. So, but I would just say, based on my kind of own experience and understanding, is recognize that when you're going into another community, you go in as a learner. You go in as one that doesn't know much of anything at all. You know, go in as one who wants to enter into learning conversations. Tell me about, be the inquisitive kind of person that has the opportunity to hear from people what life is like, and just allow the community that is in front of you to help you find a way to embrace it and for it to embrace you. And I think there are some strategies that are perhaps more helpful than others, but whenever we talk about strategy too much, it's almost like we can impose something on a circumstance or on a situation that reduces it to something it's not. And so we want to. I do think there is something to be said about discernment, something to be said about the God and His Spirit, who kind of hover over us in ways that want to help make this successful, and yet recognize how difficult this might be, because there are certain things that we may not know that may be blocks that may keep this from happening in the way we want it to. And so we have to be down for that journey. I would also say, especially if you're working with kids, prepare to be tested. In the places where I was and the kids that I worked with, it took about a year. I thought I was there for the right reasons. I didn't know if I was there for the right reasons until after this year testing, right? And they really pushed me to see that if I was there, if I was really there for them, or if I had some hidden agenda. And so I think that's part two, just be down for the process, like turn the gun sideways down, you know what I'm saying? Like, you have to be committed to the process of allowing God to reveal what's in your heart, so that you can connect with the hearts of others. And if it's not, I'm not saying that like you're fully sanctified, but there's something God puts inside you, and that continues to develop and germinate and deepen as you embrace people that are around you, in front of you, and listen and hear. Yeah.
Listening is really a skill. It isn't just like, oh, I hear you. I've been trained in community conflict transformation by South Africans, and they talk about getting into the other person's skin. And that's a process, and that it is really a honed ability to engage the other as fully human and develop that. At the risk of being self-promoting, in our program, we do have a course on community conflict transformation. Because when you bring in differences, you're gonna have disagreement, and we sometimes see that as negative. But how do we transform that aspect into something that's productive and creative, right? At the short of taking on the attitude of humbleness and moving forward and skills, it is this dimension of humility, right? I will never, ever, ever fully understand the other. Never will. But this aspect of journeying with the other, and really truly, truly listening and recognizing the other as precious, begins then to help us understand what we need to do next. Mm-hmm. But it's short of all the skills, and you're not gonna be the great female hope, and I was taught I was gonna be the great brown hope in LA, but found that out that, just like Christ, you get crucified, and that happened right away. So there is this aspect of humility that I'm here, and that's all I can be, is be present. At least Woody Allen, my mentor, said 90% of the job is not showing up, but the other 10, you really need to be grounded in terms of looking at the other and listening.
Hi. I just want to say thank you for speaking tonight. I really appreciated everything that each of you said. And I am a relatively new adjunct professor here at APU, and I attend a predominantly white church that's fairly large, that tries to be multicultural but often fails. And I've been really grieved in the past few years by the disengagement by the mainstream evangelical community at large in relation to these issues, and just the pain of our Black brothers and sisters. And I wonder how you might speak to the resistance in the church among white leadership and white churchgoers to discuss these things, and the reaction that if you talk about these things that you're being divisive, or if you insist on the importance of racial reconciliation and racial justice, that you're being the problem. So that, and then also maybe if you could speak to just how to be a bridge maker with folks who have a really hard time seeing things on a systemic level, and who have a hard time understanding the problems with some of the colorblind mindset and things like that that they've been taught are the way to go, the Christian way to go.
Can you add world peace in that one?
Jessica, why don't you too?
So I think part of the resistance stems from, a little bit what I was talking about before, this sense of comfort, right, with the kind of Christianity and the way that things are, alongside this kind of hyper-spiritualization of Galatians 3:28, right, that, there is no Jew or Gentile. That we are all one in Christ, right? So in Jesus, we're already one. So why do you even, it's all kind of been fixed. Mm-hmm. So there's a little bit this eschatological push that in the end, Jesus is going to reconcile all. In the spiritual sense, Jesus has already reconciled all. So we don't really need to worry about the divisions that exist here. In fact, to call it out is just to kind of exacerbate a problem that we're worried about the spiritual stuff, not about what's happening in this world. So I think that's part of it. But your second question was, how do you basically draw people who might be more resistant into conversations about these topics? And I think that's a very important question. And I hate to harp on this, but I really think that part of the solution is helping people enter into relationships, right, where those concerns suddenly become relevant to them because they were relevant to someone they love. So I remember Willie Jennings would talk about the power of falling in love. And he would say that, we have all these divisions in the world, but let's imagine a situation in which someone who is, let's say, a white Caucasian, doesn't know any Spanish, falls in love with someone who is a Spanish speaker, and her parents speak Spanish only. Over time, in that relationship, the one person would desire to learn this other language, right? Desire to learn to love the food that she loves and kind of the family activities that she loves, because he so desperately wants to be a part of that family. And so that type of love draws us together in a radical way, where we kind of open ourselves up to a culture and to a people that were not previously our people, right? That is the story of Gentiles joining Israel, right? That kind of coming to learn a new language, coming to learn the language of the Messiah, and to identify Jesus and say, this is the Messiah, right? That this type of language, son of David, is the Syrophoenician woman says when she comes before Jesus. That's Israel's language. That's not her language. So what does it look like then to kind of learn this new language and open ourselves up to joining together? I think that relationships and falling in love, like those type of moves, like that, I think that's where our hope lies. Because until we learn to care about the person across from us, their concerns become simply aren't relevant, right? If they don't, we don't feel like they affect us.
Mm-hmm. So we're going to take another question over here.
I want to respond to that. Someone said that the gospel is to comfort the afflicted and to afflict the comfortable, right? And so that needs to happen, because this is, you're asking a question of what it means to be a disciple or a follower of Christ. And that's not an easy pass. And I would say it's incumbent upon those that are training religious leaders, pastors, and lay people to lead. What are the skills that moves beyond that? And not everybody wants to go on that journey. And at that point then, the Greek says, you dust off your Birkenstocks and move on. But I have found many, many more who really are wanting to understand. And personally, I'm investing in that stream, because there's plenty there. And the other ones, I pray for them, because they're frightened by the world changes and the impact of what it makes on their worldview and what they believed at one time to be true. And they're finding it's no longer true.
Yeah.
Bachner gives some hope. He suggests that of the psychological responses to group contact that are possible, that the largest group that could be hopeful bridge builders in this is the marginalized group. Those that feel not at home in either culture. And I think that our world has been so kind of used to siloing things culturally that there are plenty of people that feel marginalized and don't know where they're fit in between. And I think if we invest in that group, really is reminiscent to me of Acts chapter 2, you know, when the Spirit is poured out, who hears? It's these multicultural, multi-ethnic Jews. That's the original church, the 3,000 that were saved or whatever. It's these multi-ethnic, multilingual Jews. And there's something to be said that's really important about validating those who are naturals at this bridge building, because they are of two cultures to begin with.
Mm-hmm. Let's take a question over on this side.
Yeah, I have a question about intercultural harmony and approaches to it. So I guess I'm wondering, do you think that it's better to focus on what makes us the same despite differences, or to focus on differences and learning to see them as something to celebrate?
I think those are, I don't think I would make a choice. I think both are necessary. And one of the things that I think it's really important to keep in mind is that usually, too often, the people who say, well, why don't we're all one in Christ, why do we have to talk about this? It's usually the people whose worldview is normative. So in other words, you say, well, why can't we just talk about these things that are normal? Yeah, that's right. You want to talk about the things that are normal because I'm living as a secondary person in your world. But you're not finding out what faith looks like from an experience looks like from my world. So yes, of course we talk about those things which we have in common, which we believe, which we share. And we use that as the point by which we can then say to each other, by sharing our commonalities, yes, see, I love God just like you do. Yes, and it lets you see my humanity. But then, if we are truly loving, if we are truly fulfilling the law of Christ, then I also need to be willing to find out that which breaks your heart. Because if it's breaking your heart, it breaks the heart of God.
Come over here. Me?
Yes. I'm sorry. So I just wanted to, my question was about this moment that I've been kind of thinking about. It was just a very short moment in a conversation I was having with my roommate, who was a black man. And I remember asking him a question, and in my mind it was like, I want to learn from you, who are different than me. But in hindsight, it was like, I know now that it was like a loaded question. And I've kind of figured out that it was like to get validation from him. And so my question is, where do you think that origin, what do you think the origin of that validation, like wanting that, where do you think that comes from?
Well, the system and the way that racism developed in this country has not only left a legacy of oppression, it's left a horrible trail of guilt. And because of, just like there is this sometimes, this deep well of black anger, there is a deep well of white guilt. And the reason it's particularly difficult in the time period in which we live is that we live in an individualistic society. And because we are so individualistic, there's one message that says, there's no reason for me to feel guilty. I didn't do anything. I didn't do it. Somebody else did it. Maybe my grandparents, my great-grandparents, or even farther back. And what we're losing sight of is that you may not have done it, but you do still live in a system that benefits from white privilege. And by the way, that's not an attack. It's saying we need to recognize that there's a less likelihood if you get stopped by the police that you actually may die. And so it is a hard thing. And I don't want, as a black woman, I don't want you to spend your time feeling guilty. What I want you to do is spend your time partnering with me, alongside of me, because history will show you that every civil rights movement that has succeeded has been multi-ethnic. They don't succeed when it's, you know, and in fact, this is just kind of a little, forgive me, but it's a little side annoyance. So often when there are things that are about people of color, all the people of color attend. Well, guess what? We already know it's a problem. We need you guys to join with us and kind of expand this thing.
All right, let's take a question over here.
Hi. So my question is, for individuals who are on the fence on whether or not they should support Black Lives Matter, the movement or not, I hear this argument articulated a lot, and I heard it tonight as well, that even if we don't agree with the method, we should agree with the message. And my question is, doesn't the method give a message?
Go ahead, please.
I think yes and no. One of the things we need to remember is that with a movement like Black Lives Matter, even the interpretation of Black Lives Matter goes through the visor of the racism of our nation. So let me give you a perfect example. When Dylann Roof killed that group of Christians in South Carolina, nobody said, all the whites are killing blacks. But when the black man who considered himself as a part of Black Lives Matter killed the Dallas policeman, all of a sudden there was this monolithism to assume that it was the whole movement. You see the distinction I'm making? So the distinction I'm trying to make here is, yeah, anytime you have a nascent movement, You're going to have people who say they're part of it that they may or may not really be part of it. They may say they identify it, but they may have their own brokenness and their own agenda. And there should be a willingness on our part to be as equally as right and fair, and to recognize that just like not every white person who kills a black person means all whites are racist or out to kill black people, therefore, not everybody who affiliates with the Black Lives Matter movement is necessarily really a core or integral part of that movement.
In my perspective, I may disagree, but I need to seek to understand why they felt this was an appropriate way to engage an issue on any matter. And so, because my life, maybe I will filter my reaction based on what I know and what I've experienced and how I've been taught. It's not where they've been. And if something needs to happen in a certain way, then I need to seek to understand why is that being embraced and promoted and driven, because it's not my reality. And so I need to respect them, understand, and really get into a perspective that says, if this is what they see as valid, then I need to respect that and just let it be. And in some way, support them and said, yes, do what you need to do it and to ensure that that message comes across clearly and we can have some movement on it. And it's not just the Black Lives Matter, it's other kinds of movements. In terms of what we do with immigration reform, way back when women were seeking the ability to vote, right? Those were issues that sometimes the church was not in favor of. But if people aren't moving, then we're not gonna see something happen.
On the bibliography that was handed out to you, there's an online article, and it's by a woman from the civil rights era. And she talks about how she supports what the Black Lives Matter movement is doing, but how she could not be a part of it herself, and it had to do with that the civil rights movement was, let's just face it, it was a lot more polite. And the current Black Lives Matter, that's what when I mentioned earlier when I was talking about the difference of a millennial perspective, it's much more edgy. It's much more in your face than, say, the civil rights movement was. And that's just a generational difference of communication.
Over here.
Well, good evening. My name is Dr. Hodge, and I'm actually from the Department of Criminal Justice here at APU. And so first off, I do want to commend you all for actually engaging in these types of topics, because this is what I actually cover in a lot of my courses. And so my main question, though, is whenever we have these discussions, I think the gentleman that had his first question is, what do we do next? Because a lot of APU students want to know kind of what are the steps to engaging. And so mine is more so of a comment more than a question, since that question was already addressed. And so one of the things I want to encourage you all to do is to really continue these types of discussions and to get involved and to actually take courses that are outside of your discipline that deal with issues of race, class, gender, discrimination. Because with these types of classes, it actually deals with how can you become a better student, a better advocate, a better person, a better friend. And for my students that are in criminal justice, how can you be a better law enforcement, a victimologist activist, et cetera? And so as a Christian as well, a lot of us struggle with how can we bring that within the discussion of Black Lives Matter. And so I go by the quote that is Philippians 4:13, when it mentions that I can do all things through Christ that strengthens us. So these are tough issues. But if you know that you have the work and the will of God to do, just trust and know that he'll bring you along the way. So I just want to continue to encourage you all to engage in these kind of conversations, ask these tough questions, and expand your mind to think outside of the box in order to really make not only APU a better community, but your community in general a better place to be.
Thank you. Thanks for those comments. Let's come back over here.
Good evening. My name is Deji. I'm the son of an immigrant. My father came to the U.S. in the late 1960s from Nigeria, pursuing educational opportunities. And the dean of students at his university invited him and some African immigrant students over for dinner. And midway through the dinner, he got up and he began to walk behind them. He then asked the question, "Oh, you guys don't have tails." This was serious. This was the dean of students, educated man. He said, "You guys don't have tails." My father shared that experience with me. And I think now to today, here at APU, just 2 weeks ago, I entered into an office and I was looking for a particular gentleman to speak with who was African American. And one of the assistants said, "Oh, are you looking for fill in the blank of the name?" I said, "Yes, how did you know that?" And she replied, "Oh, because a lot of people who look like you have come looking for this gentleman as well."
Okay.
I said, "Okay." So these are two stories, two different times. I share these to ask then a question for those who are employees, student employees, educators, whatever your role is here at APU. How do you keep educators, employees, and people who lead the academic world accountable to cultural and racial competency?
Wow.
I'm sorry, that story.
I want to just say a quick goodbye to Michael Mata, who has other things he has to get to. Thank you so much for being here.
Deji, that story kind of breaks my heart. I know myself as a professor of color, my students know they can talk about these things with me. I got a student, and he's actually here, but he's gonna remain nameless. And he regularly comes and tells me his stories about what's going on. Mm. And we do have issues that do happen here. And it's usually from ignorance and innocence. You do need to know, though, that we're constantly training, and the school has a strong, intentional focus to help professors, to help people understand better those ways of looking at things that are actually skewed and they don't know they're skewed. It's like one of my students had come to class and he was annoyed because he said the professor had said, told him that the experience of Africans in slavery and indentured servants was the same. Yeah, I know you said what, and it should make you say what. But that happens to be a far-right meme that is currently going around in a lot of circles, and including evangelical circles, which is to say that there was no difference in the experience of an indentured servant as it was to a slave. And so I think that just in a short way, Deji, that we can respond to it is those of us who are people of color and those of us who have an understanding of what really is that we need to continue to model the humanity of the other who is being basically otherized, because they don't know that they're doing that, but that is exactly what they're doing.
Thanks. Let's come over to this side.
Hello. I'm going to ask a question real quick and then kind of explain it so you don't misinterpret or misunderstand my question. Thank you for your talks. You, all of you, I think, addressed racism, but I don't recall anybody mentioning white supremacy. Now, let me explain that. I don't mean the KKK white supremacy. I mean the KKK, and used in academia, where whites are normative. And can you hear me? Oh, there you go. So where white is the normative, that's the default. And I see the difference between racism and white supremacy, because under racism, everybody seems to have equal power, come to the table with the same kind of status, but when we say white supremacy, there's already a structural difference. So with Black Lives Matter, we're addressing a difference of, you know, which race is normal and which is viewed less. So I guess going back to my question, how come the term white supremacy wasn't used in any of the talks?
Well, because technically speaking, while I appreciate your definitions, the technical definitions I don't believe, and my colleagues can correct me if I'm wrong, that they don't really line up that way. White supremacy means specific groups who have an ideology that says that whites are better, and it usually takes a much more radical bent. And in fact, the modern term that's being used for white supremacy is called the alt-right. So racism is probably the more correct term, because to define racism is not the same thing as prejudice. Racism is by its nature, it includes the issue of power. It always includes the issue of power. So it's not just, I don't like you because your skin's a different color. It's systems and things that are set up that make it possible for some people to get through or to succeed or to survive or to be treated a certain way, whereas that same system is designed to not let other people get through. So that's my only address. Do you guys have another one you want to?
No, I completely agree with what Dr. Winston just said. I would also mention that I think, you know, you had noted white as normative as being part of the definition of white supremacy, but I think that's absolutely part of the concept of racism too. That white is considered normative, and everyone else is evaluated based on how closely they can approximate that normative whiteness.
Thanks. Let's come over to this side.
First of all, thank you for having this discussion. I really appreciate it, and I think it's much needed for sure. So my question is, as a student of color who has attended BSA, and after every murder that there has been of a black man or a black woman, you know, we have these conversations a lot. And so my question would be, what advice would you give to students of color who, to move past the conversation? Like, what's next after that? That'll be my question.
So can you say what you mean by move past the conversation?
Yeah, sure. So every time there's a killing, Michael Brown, or just any killing, there's been a lot. We have these conversations, and so there's this dialogue about like what's next, like what do we do? But being here at a predominantly white institution, there's this, like, of course you engage in conversations because, you know, people want to know like how you are feeling. But so my question is, like, what advice would you give, if there's any advice, to move past the conversations? Like, are there any other, anything after that?
Yeah, I mean, so this is the challenge, right? I mean, we all want to be able to say, okay, what do we do next? What do we do? How do we fix this? And those are, that's a great impulse. But I also wonder whether part of it is maybe not asking the question, what do we do? And being able to ask the question, how do we become the people that we need to be, right? So not only within the small community that was willing to talk about it, right, and have dialogue, and I think there's never a time that we should be beyond dialogue, but also all of us, right? How do we become the people that we need to be? And I think by focusing on identity formation, right, as opposed to particular actions that need to take place, that maybe it's going to be, you know, the transformation is going to be real. I don't know if that does that make sense? I can't see you, so.
any other panelists want to say something on that? That's a good question.
I don't want to be discouraging, but I'm 62 almost, And I think it's because when you come right down to it, racism isn't a skin thing, it's a sin thing. And because I can move forward, I can do what God calls me to do, I can serve. But I don't really expect this to stop being an issue throughout my lifetime. I don't think, so when President Obama was elected, I was among those that was thrilled and cried, but also knew in my heart we were headed for a racial backlash. And so I guess what I'm saying is, you have, like you're saying, you have these discussions and you say, what do we do next? Well, you serve, you love, you humbly are willing to educate your friends who are not people of color so that they know you. And they, and especially, I think one of the best things we could do is to give white people a safe place to ask questions and not feel like, oh, I'm scared, I'm gonna ask this, the wrong dumb one, okay? And give them a safe place to answer, that we can answer those and partner. But I don't necessarily think that the journey actually ends. I mean, it's because it's partially, it's not moments of activism that are going to achieve it. It's living together in faith and love that's going to achieve it.
Thanks.
Hello, hello. All right, good afternoon. My name's Isaiah. My question is specifically for you, Professor in the pink. I came a little late. And that's no offense to nobody else on the panel, and I think that when I explain what I'm about to say that you understand. You you said that you were raised in Chicago, yes?
In the Chicago area.
Okay. I don't know where, you know, exactly, and I don't really think it matters, but I think that not only you and everybody else here in the stands has half an idea of what's going on in Chicago right now with the violence and everything. And I was born in Chicago. My mama raised on the west side, my father on the south. And, you know, when I go back home, Chicago is a wasteland. And I think that, you know, you were saying how the millennial difference in back in the day was more, it was more peaceful with the movements and stuff like that. And I think that's part of which, because I know if they was, you know, getting froggy and really riled up, that, you know, it wouldn't have been taken serious. It would have just been met with resistance, like you saw in LA, you know what I'm saying, with the riots and stuff there. And I think you kind of have to be. I think that the difference is now we kind of feel like all that, well, we're told always that, you know, that was back in the day and none of it exists anymore. And I feel like if that's the case, you know, I think we all kind of feel as black people, if that's the case, you know what I'm saying, then why are we still seeing it, you know? And we're upset and we lash out. And when I go home, you know, I think my question would be is, a lot of people don't even really, you know, we do have a lot of black people that are part of the movement and want to come out here, but I know that there are a lot of them who have no hope and don't even care about the movement, period, because they feel there is no hope. And my question would be, if there is any advice, what do you say to that? Because a lot of times, you know, that's always the critique, you know, when we say stuff, you know, white or black. I've seen black and white, you know, Asian, doesn't matter. People say, well, it needs to start with you guys in your own communities. And I never really have too much to say because I agree 100%. You know, we kill each other every day. And when I go home, Chicago, every time I see it, I could be there for 3 days and 30 people get popped. And in 3 days, 30 people will die. And when I'm riding around with my cousin, I know that he has a weapon under his seat. I'm not really going to tell him too much because I know how it is in that area. And if he were to have to use it and somebody were to lose that life that night, I'm not going to think twice about it because I'd rather it be somebody else than me and my family. And I don't really, you know, I feel like a hypocrite in almost trying to tell them, like, you know, we need to lay the guns down and we need to, you know, all come out here for this black light of, you know, this Black Lives Matter movement, but that's not the reality. So if I guess it was just my question really is just like, what advice do you have to combat all that?
That's a big one. You know, I think that there is a really great example. And it's a movement that has happened here in Los Angeles. And it's called the Homeboy Industries through Father Boyle. And I think personally, part of the problem in Chicago and one of the big differences now that I see in the African American community that is very different than when I grew up is that we really believed in that idea of it takes a village. And the church was at the center of it. There's a lot of the black church, a lot of the black community, the church is not at the center anymore. And there's a hopelessness that has set in because of it. Because see, when if I was a little girl and I acted up, Mrs. So-and-so whooped me. And then because Mrs. So-and-so had had to whoop me, Mama whooped me twice as hard because there was that sense of ownership. But now things have become, if I see a little black child, and I live in a primarily black and Latino neighborhood, and if I see them in certain trouble, or if they're about to do something that I think that might be a threat to their life, and I'll be gentle and I'll say something to them, not only will they cuss me out, but then their mother will come along and call me everything but the son of God. And so I think that one of the big issues and one of the big problems has been such a deep onset of hopelessness and a loss of the center of faith mooring. Even for a lot of black people who go to church, they may still go to church and they have a good time and we shout and God really showed up, which is mean you and really enjoyed the music and, you know, whatever. But is God showing up making any difference in changing your life? And so that's just in a small way what I would say. I would say there has been such an ongoing deep, deep, deep well of a not only a materialism that is so entrenched that that materialism, I gotta have the most expensive Nikes or whatever they are, forgive me if I don't know what they are because I don't pay attention to really expensive tennis shoes. Okay, so, but whatever it is, not only is there that deep well of that materialism that is replaced the deep well of the sense of community, but also there's become this hopelessness, which takes us back to what I think, and I had said in the chapel not too long. The bottom line is we need to be praying for revival in our nation.
All right. I can't really see how many are in line, but we're going to do two more from each side. I'm sorry. I know that's probably going to cut some people off, but let's come over here.
I have a question for Dr. Winston, and it was also a question for Professor Mata, but since he's left, Dr. Winston will ask you. Several times you and he have made the comment that you don't agree with their methods, but first, you've never told us what their methods are, and secondly, you haven't told us why you disagree with them, which kind of leaves the implication that somehow their methods are not legitimate. And I don't think that's your intent, but I think you need to clarify that. As I understand, it's a very peaceful movement, even as you commented yourself, that the one guy who killed the Dallas cop was doing it on his own. The Black Lives Matter has always stood, for instance, if a white person gets killed by the police, it's the Black Lives Matter that are there, people that are there to support him and his family. So tell us what their methods are, tell us why you disagree, and then you know, hopefully it'll be a sympathetic treatment. I know it will be.
Well, I think you might have misunderstood what I did say, because I never said I didn't agree with their methods. I said there are those who disagree with their methods. And it's the issue is not one as much as it is methods, as it is from the difference of a worldview from generationally and age-wise. The bottom line of most of the people in the Black Lives Matter movement is they're doing edgier forms of protests, still peaceful. And they, in fact, still use some of the same methods that they got. In fact, one of the articles that I mentioned that's on the thing was members of what had originally been called SNCC, which was the Student Nonviolent Christian, I think it was Christian Coalition, which was the student group that was supported the original civil rights movement. Pardon me? Coordinating committee, thank you. So that group has talked about how much they support what they are doing. I support what they're doing. Now, sometimes the only difference is maybe I wouldn't use the same set of words. That's all. We're talking about a difference in generation and a difference of whether it be dressing a certain way or respect a certain way, or for example, maybe I wouldn't call the police pigs. You know, it's just small stuff. We're just talking small stuff. We're not talking big stuff. So, I'm saying I'm not denigrating that, and I know for a fact that Michael Motto was not denigrating that either. What we're saying, and in fact, what we're trying to say, when I talk about the issue of methods, I'm more addressing to try to help people who have looked at aspects of Black Lives Matter and wanted to invalidate what they're doing and to say we need to be willing to support what they are doing, because what they are doing is a method for this time, which, in other words, we should not expect them to do it exactly the same way that the civil rights movement did it. Did I answer that adequately? Okay, thanks.
Yeah. Good evening.
You have to forgive us, because we can see nothing. We just see, this is like the Spanish Inquisition. We can only see the voice. We only see the lights.
Good evening. I had a conversation recently with a man in which I said something about profiling, and the man replied, "Are you under the impression I think profiling is wrong?" He went on to say that he treats racial profiling the way I, as a woman, might avoid walking on the same side of the street as a man late at night because I'm statistically more likely to be attacked by a man. He said that the statistics were on his side and he was simply doing what he thought was going to keep him safe. This produced a lot of questions for me. My question for the panel is this. If statistics are a valid reason for treating people differently in the name of safety, how do we change people's internal associations, biases, and prejudices regarding race and other divisive social borders?
That's a great question.
That's a very good question. I'm not sure if statistics should determine how we treat other people. Because I don't know of the statistics. I mean, let's say that the statistics were I am 99.9% to get mugged if I step outside after 12 p.m., right? Or 12 a.m., yeah. Then I probably wouldn't do it. But that's not the kind of statistics that we're talking about here. And I don't know if numbers should determine kind of how we engage people in the world and how we, how we encounter one another.
The other thing is that, to be perfectly honest, the whole issue of statistics is a fallacy. And here's what I mean by that. People will tell you certain things, and there are certain things in the common lexicon of racial issues that are just false. Let's take Ferguson, for example. Ferguson, Missouri is, of course, the city where Michael Brown was killed. And one of the statistics that the Department of Justice discovered was that though blacks in Ferguson represented 67% of the population, they represented 93% of the arrests. And every single one of the people who were, what's the word, when they would stop them for things like disturbing the peace or whatever. The point I'm making is we've got a bunch of stereotypes that have, do we go, oh, I thought I went out, okay. We have a bunch of stereotypes that have gone on that just aren't true. So for example, here's another big stereotype. This common stereotype is that blacks are on welfare. For a long time, if you look up the statistics, what you'll discover is ethnically the most people receiving welfare are white. So there's a bunch of different statistics that are always used to justify certain treatment and certain ways of viewing communities of color and of profiling that actually just aren't true. They're just not true.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And I also think that, again, the way that we see people, right, determines kind of, in many ways, what Jackie was alluding to at one point, was it determines the statistics that we then encounter, right? So we expect that more black men will be violent. Statistically speaking, we find that there are more arrests of black men, right? Or when it comes to conviction rates, right? So a black man and a white man who are charged for the same crime, statistically speaking, the black man will get a harsher sentence than the white man. So then our prisons are full of black men, and then we think to ourselves, oh, black men must be more violent. They must be more like a criminal, right? Because our prisons are full of them. When in fact, it's our expectation of that that leads to those statistics, not the actual actions that are taken.
Okay, we're gonna go with one more from each side, and then if you still have further questions, I'm gonna invite you up to speak with our panelists directly.
Hi, my name is Larry Handy. I work at library. Hey. I have a comment, and then I have just two short questions. You know, comment basically is, you know, my friend, Dr. Thorson, punches me in my nose and breaks it, and he asks for forgiveness, and I forgive him, we're fine. But my nose still needs time to heal. Right. Now, with that question, what about the psychological effects of racism? Does anybody have anything to say about that? Because the question was raised earlier, why are we still talking about racism? Well, my comment is that it could be because people are still healing and they haven't had enough time to heal. As a former caregiver of my grandmother who had dementia, my grandmother was raised in under segregation in Mississippi in the 1920s. So during her dementia, she started having flashbacks of Jim Crow. Mm-hmm. Now, I was born in 77. I'm the first person in my family, you know, post-segregation. I had to deal with Jim Crow by being her caregiver. She wouldn't even want to have to use the restroom because she felt that she was in a white person's home. She was going back to that, flashbacks. During my 19 years of working at APU, I have been stopped by LA County Sheriff 5 times. Not stopped, but manhandled, meaning thrown against a cop car, made to sit on the curb. I've been fondled by cops looking for drugs. I've been not called racial slurs, but I've been, like, they'll talk to me like, hey man, where you going, man? You know, put your hand behind your back, I'm axing you. And I don't even speak that way. But the cops are talking to me as if I do. That's racism. And you better believe that after that happened to me, I still had to go to work the next day. And I went through depression. Mm-hmm. I went through anxiety. I have had nightmares. Now, I can afford $50 an hour to go to counseling, but the average brother from the hood can't afford $50 an hour to go to counseling. You know what I mean? And a lot of the violence is happening, a lot of the substance abuse is happening, a lot of the family breakdown is a result of depression that people can't afford to deal with. It's self-hatred. So can anybody talk about the psychological effects? Because we talk about the PTSD associated with war, associated with bullying, but what about racism as well? Because if my grandmother has flashbacks, and if I went through depression, it's a common thing that's happening. What is the church doing, aside from saying forgiveness, because it takes time to heal? My second question also is my friend Shane here was saying, is there a group on campus here that can continue the discussion and we're standing for with the issues. Time and place. Yeah, we want action. Thank you.
Well, one of the things that God taught me very early on, I had a background of having been abused in a bunch of different ways. And one of the things that God said to me was, just because people treat you like trash doesn't make you trash. And if anybody has the equipment for the redemptive work of God's love, it is we who call upon his name. And yeah, I know you don't make much money because you work here. So, so I know you don't have a lot of money. Okay. So, but in spite of that, obviously, there are different various types of resources available, but the resource that we really do have, and I don't mean this in a platitudinous way, we do have Jesus, who, like us, suffered and was tempted in all ways as we are, yet without sin, and who knows the very image of Jesus's laying down his life on our behalf and then rising from the dead, gives us a model for how the redemptive work of Christ can not only heal us from the ways in which we've been broken, but also how we can rise over it victoriously.
I want to say amen to that, and I also want to say that even though I can't see you at all, thank you. Oh, there you are. Okay. Okay. Thank you. And I want to say this in the way that I feel it. Thank you for having the courage to share what you've shared. It would be hard for me to share that. And there are things in my life that are hard to share. And there are certain people that I couldn't trust with those things that are hard to share. But you have trust us to share that. And so I want to say thank you for the courage for that. Yeah. And I think it would be very great to continue that conversation. And I would be open to being a part of that group, whatever this is and whatever it looks like. So thank you.
I think that's an excellent question. And I think that you're absolutely right. The psychological impact of racism is one of the most difficult aspects of racism. Because it not only affects someone in the immediate situation, right? But it is an ongoing, it has an ongoing effect. And I think it has an effect that could even lead people, you mentioned self-hatred. I think it, you know, the consequences are so huge. I mean, you think about school children who are told over and over again, like, this is what you're capable of, this is what you're capable of, this is what you're capable of, and then you start to believe that of yourself. So one book that I found quite helpful, it's not really a pastoral kind of book, but more in terms of psychological theory and race, is it's called The Colonization of the Psyche. I think that's the title. It's last name is Oliver, and it's an excellent book, but it's basically about the black colonization of black peoples and the psychological consequences of it. So I would, if anyone's interested, you should look it up. Kelly Oliver.
Thanks. And our last question.
Hello, everyone. This is more of a comment. It's 7:05, which means everyone here is 35 minutes past when this event goes. And the only reason I say that is just over the next minute or two, just consider the fact that for whatever reason, you are still here. Mm-hmm. And I want to focus on one quote. Dr. Winston says, just like there is a well of black anger, there is a well of white guilt. We need to move past being sensitive to what it means to kind of be people who are offended often by what is unfamiliar to us. You see, there's this, like, it's an obsession. I will say it's an obsession in the modern church amongst young adults of, like, feeling convicted and not doing anything about it. Like, I've been going to, you know, service throughout time at APU, and, like, you'll literally get in the car with some buddies after church and be like, how was the service? Oh, man, like, it was convicting this morning. And they leave it at that. And it's like there needs to be a spirit of agreement to dive deeper into these things, or else it's going to be in vain. And, like, I understand that a lot of these panels and a lot of these discussions on campus, they happen for extra credit. And, you know, there's this purpose of awareness. But at the same time, a lot of professors say, you know, if you come to these, get a signature, and, you know, it's kind of this ideal, there's this incentive here. But I'm saying that, like, you've already had your extra credit. Like, you're here 35 minutes later. And I just want to challenge us to be people who, if you came, I'm just going to be very blunt, if you're a group of white friends and you came with white friends and you don't later tonight say, hey, I think we need to specifically meet on how to listen better, then I think this was a waste of time for us tonight. And for those of you who are wondering, like, okay, where do we go from here? Everyone right now is receptive and everyone right now is convicted. So this is like a perfect time, once this splits, to just be like, hey, when are you able to get a meal on campus? When are you able to truly be heard? And I think that, like, honestly, these panels exist. Like, the heart of the panel here is that this is a call to action. And I just want to say to us, like, may we not be people who are passive and just kind of are content with what it means to have that conviction, because that conviction is from the Lord, and the Lord is saying to us, okay, the seed has been planted. There have been these times. What are we going to do next? And just real quick, I'll say that there are prayer meetings that are going on this semester, and if you'd like to hear more about those, I'd be glad to talk. Also, if you're a person of color who wants to vent, I'm someone who knows they're going into urban ministry after college, and I want the truth, and I want you guys to understand that I do not sense in my own life that I have all the answers. I know I want to go to a place where whites are the minority, but I don't know what that looks like fully. So please come up to me and let's talk and let's really get this thing going. So I appreciate it. I appreciate the panel is very authentic tonight, and thank you guys.
Thank you. So that's the end of our comments, but we have one announcement about the Black Student Association. Go ahead and...
Hi, my name is Tajiana. I just wanted to say to the students and faculty and whoever is still left here that BSA meets on Thursday nights at 7:30, so like soon. And you guys are always welcome when 1:30. Doesn't matter what you look like, just everybody comes so we can keep having these discussions. And I would strongly encourage faculty to come as well, because we don't want the dialogue to be limited to just students on campus. We want everybody to hear. So I would just encourage everybody to come out. All right. Good night.
Let me pray for us before we go. Holy God, give us the courage we need. Give us the wisdom we need. Give us the anger we need. Give us the compassion we need to work for your justice. We pray these things in the name of the brown-skinned, brown-eyed Jewish Jesus. Amen.